Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you and bless your name, Lord God. We thank you for your provisions. In this time of year, in the American culture, we remember your blessings and your goodness to us and the needs that you've met in our lives. We come before you, Lord God, now, asking that in the power of your Spirit, you speak to us through your word, for the praise of your glory and the edification of your people. In Jesus' name, we ask, amen. Turn with me, please, to the book of Leviticus, chapter 23, the 23rd chapter, of Exodus. Exodus 23, please. Then we'll look at Leviticus 23. Exodus 23. Verse 14. 3 times a year you shall celebrate a feast to me. You shall observe the feast of unleavened bread. For 7 days you are to eat unleavened bread, as I commanded you at the appointed time in the month of Aviv. For in it you came out of Egypt, and none shall appear before me empty-handed. Also you shall observe the feast of the harvest of the first fruits of your labors from what you sow in the field. Also the feast of the ingathering at the end of the year when you gather the fruit of your labors from the field. 3 times a year all your males shall appear before the Lord. You shall not offer the blood of my sacrifice with leavened bread, nor is the fat of my feast to remain overnight until morning. You shall bring the choice first fruits of your soil into the house of the Lord your God. You are not to boil a kid in the milk of its mother. Ancient Israel had 3 Thanksgivings. 3 Thanksgivings. They were called the Pilgrim Feasts. The first was the week following Passover, the week following Pesach, called Chag Matzot, the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And it was the first day of this week was the Feast of First Fruits. The Sunday of that week was the Feast of First Fruits. It's when Jesus rose from the dead. They would thank God for the first fruits. Now, of course, we understand from 1 Corinthians 15 what that means. It means Jesus is the first fruit of the resurrection. The high priest would go into the Kidron Valley on the first Thanksgiving of the Hebrew year, the first of the three. He'd go into the Kidron Valley at sunrise when it was still dark, standing between the Mount of Olives and the Temple Mount. And he would look for the first little stalk of grain coming out of the earth. And when he saw the first pin of light coming up on back of the Mount of Olives, he would ritually harvest it, calling it the first fruit, and then bring it into the temple. That was the task of the high priest. But it had to still be dark, yet the first pin of light had to be seen. At the very hour of the very day when the high priest was bringing the first fruit into the temple, the Lord Jesus was raising from the dead. Same day of the year, same hour of the same day, 1 Corinthians 15, he is the first fruit. The first thing the Hebrews had to thank God for was the first fruit. The first thing we thank God for is the lamb that was slain rose from the dead. That was the first Thanksgiving. The second came 7 weeks later, what the Jews called Chag Shavuot, the Feast of Weeks. Christians know it as the Day of Pentecost. And again, it would be the morrow day, the first day of the week. By that time, what began as the first stalks of grain was now grown into the spring harvest. The full crop was there. They would harvest that, and again, there would be a Thanksgiving offering to God, thanking God for the provision. That was the second Hebrew Thanksgiving. But the one we're concerned with today is the autumn one, because we're in the autumn, and it was their autumn. The third one is this one that we read about, the ingathering. Chag Sukkot, the Feast of Booths, or Feast of Tabernacles. Chag Sukkot, the autumn Thanksgiving. You had 2 harvest seasons and 2 rainy seasons. You know the former and latter rain, so you had 2 harvests. And at this time of year, approximately 3 weeks ago, the Hebrews celebrated their autumn Thanksgiving. There are 3 aspects of this autumn Thanksgiving. 3 aspects. Turn with me, please, now to Leviticus chapter 23, and let's understand the Jewish Thanksgiving as fulfilled in Christ. Verse 39, on exactly the 15th day of the 7th month, when you have gathered in the crops of the land, you shall celebrate the feast of the Lord for 7 days, with a rest on the first day and a rest on the 8th day. Now, the word there is actually a Sabbath or a Shabbat. Now, on the first day, you shall take for yourselves the foliage of beautiful trees, palm branches and boughs of leafy trees and willows of the brook, and you shall rejoice before the Lord your God for 7 days. You shall thus celebrate it as a feast to the Lord for 7 days in the year. It shall be a perpetual statute through all your generations. You shall celebrate it in the 7th month. You shall live in booths for 7 days. All the native born in Israel shall live in booths, so that your generations may know that I had the sons of Israel live in booths when I brought them out of the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. So Moses declared to the sons of Israel the appointment times of the Lord. Understand this Thanksgiving. The same as at this time of year, when we have Thanksgiving, and of course, people look to football games and all that kind of stuff, I'm talking about what it really came from, when the pilgrims arrived on the Mayflower and they went through the whole thing and so forth. We look back and we thank God that God preserved them through this first difficult years in this country. We look back and we remember God's provision when they were coming into a new land, leaving an old one. That very much is an adoption of what the Feast of Tabernacles means. It's the Jewish feast of remembering God's provision in the past. There are three aspects to the Feast of Tabernacles, to the Jewish Thanksgiving of the autumn, to the Hebrew Thanksgiving. There is the Messianic, the Millennial, and the Memorial. The Messianic aspect to do with Christ in His first coming, the Millennial aspect to do with the return of Christ, and the Memorial, remembering God's provision in times past. God gave the Hebrews these holy days for certain reasons. One reason He gave them these holy days were quite simply they were a polemic against paganism. The Canaanites and the other religions of the land had holy days the same day. Only instead of thanking the true God for the rain and the sun and the harvest, they were thanking demon gods. Moses called these other gods demons in Hebrew, Shadim. They were thanking Baal, or they were thanking Molech or something like this. God wanted His people to thank the true God for His provision. It was a polemic against paganism. The pagans, the Canaanites, had sacrifices and Thanksgiving days on the same days of the year. Polemic against paganism. Okay? The second aspect is that these things were shadows of the Messiah. They were pictures of what the Messiah would do and the order in which He would do them. They were pictures of what Jesus would do. But the third aspect, and the one that we're concerned with today, is Thanksgiving. God wanted His people to remember the needs He met in the past as a way to engender faith to trust Him for the future and the present. This is important. I'm not saying that everyone should celebrate Hebrew feasts. I'm not even saying you have to celebrate Thanksgiving. I'm appealing to the principle. How many times were you and I up a tree? How many times were you in a real jam? Maybe academically, maybe financially, maybe in health, maybe maritally, maybe in a combination of ways. Maybe your life was caving in on you. Maybe it's caving in on you today. God wants us to remember the things He did for us in the past. Never forget to commit to memory, a memorial, with thanksgiving, the needs He's already met. Why? Because He's due the praise and the thanks? Of course He is. But it's as much for our benefit as it is to the praise of His glory. He will use that commemoration of the things He's already done for us to engender, to build up the faith, to trust Him for the present and the future. Today, maybe you're going through something. Maybe you're going through something with finance, with health, with marriage, with career, with education. Maybe you're going through some challenge. Maybe some member of your family, a husband, a wife, a child, sibling, is going through something. Maybe your parents, your family is facing something. I'm sure even in a crowd this size, there are people here facing these kinds of challenges, and their faith is being attacked. And of course, the devil will get a hand in this and try to amplify it and use it for his purpose. Well, a good place to begin is Thanksgiving. When you're under pressure and your life is caving in on you, you don't feel like thanking God for anything. First, get me out of here, then I'll thank you. Get me out of this mess so I can thank you. Get me out of this mess so I can praise you. Do something, and then I'll come and say thank you. No. Misunderstandings. Remember what he's done for you already. Remember the last time you were up the proverbial tree, up the proverbial creek without the proverbial paddle, not to be vulgar in a church. Remember the last time you were in up to your eyeballs and over your head, and he got you out of it. He did it then. He can do it again. He's the same God. So we have the messianic aspect. Let's just briefly look at that first, although it's not our purpose today. We have to do justice to it. Turn with me to John chapter 7. Now you have to understand something. There were, again, as we just read in Leviticus 23, remembering God's provision in the wilderness. But his provision in the wilderness was not only the manna. It was the water when Moses struck the rock. In a desert, the most important thing is water. So they thank God not just for food, but for water. Look, please, to John chapter 7. And it's against this background Jesus speaks on what we call the last day of the great feast in John chapter 37. Now, on the last day of the great day of the feast, Yeshua, Jesus, stood and cried out, saying, "If any man is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture said, from his innermost being shall flow rivers of living water. But this he spoke of the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were to receive. For the Spirit was not yet given, because Yeshua was not yet glorified." In the Old Covenant, the Holy Spirit was only for certain people at certain times. High priests, kings, prophets, judges, patriarchs. Certain people at certain times. It's not like now, where it's for all who believe, all who are born again, all who have repented and accepted Jesus on the basis of faith in what he did for us and what he's going to do for us in the future. So they thank God for the water, and it's against this background that Yeshua, Jesus, appeals to the background of Ezekiel 47. And he says, "If anyone is thirsty, come to me. I'll give you living water." This he spoke of the Holy Spirit. The rain would come down on Israel, and it goes into the water table, and it forms something called Maim Chaim, living water. Turn with me, please, very briefly to Isaiah chapter 44, verse 3. "I will pour out water on the thirsty land, streams on the dry ground. I will pour out my Spirit on your offspring and my blessings on your descendants." The water coming down, the outpouring of rain, is a metaphor in biblical typology or imagery for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. He pours out his Spirit, the rain goes into the water table and forms the Maim Chaim, the living water. But it wells up from within us. And it's against this background we see the messianic fulfillment of tabernacles, of Jewish thanksgiving. We thank God, of course, for his Spirit. Because Jesus has been glorified, his Spirit is here. No matter what you're going through, no matter what you're facing or may face, his Spirit will guide you. In the wilderness, when the Hebrews commemorated God's provision in the wilderness, the Shekinah went before them in the ark. Now, the Shekinah also goes before us, but we are the ark. As it were, it's inside of us. You think that same Shekinah that led the children of Israel, that led a nation through a wilderness, the wilderness of this fallen world, will lead us. We come out of Egypt, the metaphor for the world in the Bible. Egypt is a picture of the world. Pharaoh is a picture of Satan, the god of this world, and a type of the Antichrist. And most of you know, as Moses made a covenant with blood and sprinkled it on the people and took them out of Egypt through the water, through the wilderness to the promised land, is a picture of the way that Jesus sprinkles us with his blood, takes us through baptism out of the world, through this wilderness of this life into the promised land. No, we have not yet entered the promised land, but we have certainly come out of Egypt. we are in a wilderness. And in this wilderness, there are vultures. There is a scorching sun that can cause people to dehydrate and suffer heat stroke. I had to do training in the Israeli army when I was younger. I couldn't do it now, but we used to have these big water containers on our back, and you carry more weight in water than you did in bullets. And we, as a serious, and you'd walk a kilometer, and you'd run a kilometer with this big thing on you, and walk, I'm not just a pack and a rifle, and plus the water, we call it Yerikan. You'd walk, and then you'd have to run. Walking, as you can see, I couldn't do it now. I'm like the camel. Water is the key to survival. Vultures hover overhead, waiting for someone or something to die, so they'll have something to eat. They're just waiting. So as Israel went through this wilderness, God had to provide for them. And it's against this background that we have the messianic fulfillment. But then there is a millennial fulfillment of Thanksgiving. You see, we have to thank God not only for what He has done, but for what He is going to do. Turn with me, please, to the book of Zechariah, chapter 14. In chapter 12, we see the return of Christ. They look upon Him who they have pierced. In chapter 13, we see the nations aligned for the battle of Armageddon and then for the judgment in the Valley of Jehoshaphat. But once Jesus comes and sets His feet on the Mount of Olives, we see what will happen. Verse 16, it'll come about that any who are left of all the nations that went up against Jerusalem will go up from year to year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to celebrate the Feast of Booths, the Jewish Thanksgiving. And it will be that whichever of the families of the earth does not go up to Jerusalem to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, there will be no rain upon them. Physical rain, but also God withholding His Spirit. And if the family of Egypt does not go up or enter, then no rain will fall on them. It'll be the plague with which the Lord smites the nations who do not go up to celebrate the Feast of Booths. This will be the punishment of Egypt and the punishment of all the nations who do not go up to celebrate the Feast of Booths. And that day there will be inscribed on the bells of the horses, Holy to the Lord. And the cooking vessels in the Lord's house will be like the bowls before His altar. And every cooking vessel in Jerusalem and Judah will be holy to the Lord of hosts. And all whose sacrifice will come to take of them and boil in them. And there will no longer be a Canaanite in the house of the Lord in that day. There will be no unsaved people. There will be no non-believers. The Lord Jesus will rule the nations with a rod of iron. All who are here will be holy unto the Lord. And again, you've got this big, big, big celebration when people are cooking things in big cooking vessels. This is the Thanksgiving I'm really looking forward to. I'm not putting down turkey next Thursday. I shall be in England. Eating beef bangers and mash, or fish and chips. However, the Thanksgiving we need to look forward to is this one, when all the nations will gather and worship the King of Kings in Jerusalem. This is what He's going to do. Just think, no more abortion, no more pornography on the internet, people spamming you disgusting stuff. No more social injustice, no more racism, no more crime, no more violence, no more sexually transmitted diseases, no more crooked politicians, no more false religion. None of that stuff. We will indeed have something to celebrate when Jesus rules from Jerusalem in the millennium. But we should be giving thanks for that already. Now people ask, why will you have sacrifices in the millennium and who will these people be? There will be two kinds of people at the coming Thanksgiving feast. There will be us who have been saved now. And there will be those who are the descendants of those who survived the Great Tribulation, both Jew and Gentile. The Feast of Booths represents the millennium to Jews. That is why when Jesus was transfigured on the Mount of Transfiguration, which was Mount Hermon, Har Hermon, when Peter saw Moses and Elijah, he wanted to build three booths. He thought, that's it. Here's the Messiah, here's Moses, here's Elijah. It must be the millennium. What happened there is the clearest picture we have of the rapture and resurrection. You have a man who died faithful to God, Moses, and a man who was raptured and never died, Elijah. And you have Jesus, but they all look the same. They were all transfigured. We shall be as he is. It doesn't matter if you're alive in Christ when he comes, and you're raptured like Elijah, or you're dead in Christ when he comes, like Moses, we shall all meet him in the air. Mount Hermon, highest mountain in the Middle East and in Israel, where Galilee, Lebanon, and Syria come together. Snow caps 7.5 months of the year, approximately. And I suppose if you're going to Israel in February, you will see it. You'll see that's where Jesus went up above Caesarea Philippi. Peter thought that was the millennium. He thought it was the Feast of Booths. He thought it was the Thanksgiving to come. It wasn't, but it teaches about it. It doesn't matter if you're dead in Christ or alive in Christ. Maybe you're battling a heart disease or a cancer or something like this, and you're afraid you're going to snuff it. It didn't matter that Moses snuffed it and Elijah was raptured. They were the same. We shall be as he is. There's no dead and there's no living. There's just those who are alive in Christ. This is going to be a reality on this planet. I believe in heaven. I believe in the certainty of heaven. But the fact of the matter is, heaven is so good and so incomprehensible to us that we need a 1,000-year training course to get ready for it. The original plan that God had for this planet is what the millennium is going to be like. Those who are saved now will co-reign with Christ in this coming Thanksgiving. Like him in his resurrection, we'll have the same bodies, but they'll be different. He could even walk through walls. The other people who are the descendants of those who were survivors of the Great Tribulation, they will actually live to be the same age as antediluvian man. These people will actually live to be hundreds of years old. They'll live to be as old as Methuselah. Nearly 1,000 years. If somebody dies at the age of 120, it will be considered a pediatric fatality. That's what we're told in Isaiah. It will be the crib death syndrome. Death was never God's idea. Death was not God's idea. His idea was life. We're going to have something to give thanks for when Jesus sets up his kingdom. We're going to have those cooking vessels. There'll be plenty of turnips. Plenty of turkey, but above all, there'll be plenty of Jesus. Thanksgiving is coming. Have a good Thursday, but that's only the appetizer for what's really going to come. So we have the second aspect, we have the millennial aspect. But then we have this third aspect, the memorial one, the aspect of memorial. Remembering his provision in the wilderness. Sojourning in the wilderness is not a happy experience. Sometimes in the wilderness, when they were sojourning those 40 years, all kinds of things happened, both good and bad. 40 is the number of testing in the Bible, isn't it? Moses fasted 40 days and 40 nights. Jesus fasted 40 days and 40 nights. It rained 40 days with Noah. They sojourned 40 years in the wilderness. 40 years. Only the second generation after the promised land, not the first. Only the new creation can go to heaven, not the old. No, we have not entered the promised land yet. It'll happen. The meek will inherit the earth one day. And we'll have a real Thanksgiving. But we no longer eat at the flesh pots of Egypt. We've been saved out of the world. If you were to walk from Phoenix to Los Angeles, you're going to go through a brutal desert. Imagine what it was like for the pioneers when nobody was here with the Apaches and they were the only ones who knew how to survive in it. Would have been a brutal trek, wouldn't it? Arizona then doesn't look like what it looks like now. Nowhere to stop along I-10 for a drink on a hot day. Imagine having to walk to Las Vegas in the heat of July and August. Well, that's what our sojourn in this world is like. That's what it would have been like for the Hebrews who came out of Egypt. The sun beating down. Vultures and serpents. Here it's rattlesnakes. In the Sinai is vipers. And if anybody straggled off and got away from the flock, they would be food for animals of prey. Satan goes around like a roaring lion, seeing whom he can devour. It was hot, it was difficult, but at least they had each other. No, they had not entered the promised land, but at least they were no longer slaves in Egypt. And they were promised the promised land by a God who does not break his promises. He gave them everything they needed in that wilderness. Sometimes they saw tremendous miracles. Sometimes they didn't. Sometimes the Shekinah moved in power. Sometimes he did not. Sometimes there were victories. Other times there were disappointments. But no matter what happened, the manna fell every day. He gave them the water they needed because the rock was struck. And we're told in Corinthians that rock is Christ. His living water will sustain you through the wilderness of this world. His food will always come from heaven, and it will be sweet as manna. He gave them each other. He gave them faithful shepherds like Moses and Caleb and Aaron and Joshua. And he gave them his spirit. He also gave them his word, his map, how to get to the promised land. He gave them everything they needed. And as we go through this life with its difficulties and its challenges as well as its blessings, its disappointments as well as its victories, that same God will give you and me, your church and my church, your family and my family, everything we need to get through this barren wilderness till we reach the promised land. But let's go back to this idea of the Feast of Booths. Of celebrating in memorial of what he has done for us. You have a Thursday in this country. Ancient Israel had a whole week. And they built this booth, this sukkah, where they would dwell in the booth and take their meals in the booth. Orthodox Jews will do that to this day. They'll go into the booth. And they will have these festal meals. But Jews do something else this particular day and during this week in this booth. They read the book of Ecclesiastes, HaMegillat Kohelet. The world has its philosophers, Hobbes and Bentham, Aristotle and Plato, Schopenhauer and Spinoza, Nietzsche and Hegel. The world has its philosophers and its philosophies. God, however, has his philosophy of life. There is a divine philosophy. God's philosophy, the divine book of philosophy, is the book of Ecclesiastes. What is God's philosophy of life? How we should live in this place? Quite simple. It is futile to trust in it. Vanity of vanity, says the preacher. All is vanity. The same junk will always happen again. Doesn't matter how rich and powerful you become, you're going to wind up just as dead and broke as a poor man. No matter how high and mighty you become, when you're dead, you're dead. It's frustrating. It's futile. It is vain to trust in this fallen world. Who wants to set their hope in a wilderness when we have a promised land waiting for us? That's God's philosophy of life. His philosophy of life, simply stated, make the best of a bad thing. A better place awaits. Enjoy the wife of your youth. Delight in his blessings. If blessings increase, praise the Lord. If prosperity increases, praise the Lord for that, but don't set your heart on it. The only thing you're going to take with you is the things you give to Jesus when you're alive. That's his philosophy. Love God and keep his commandments. If you live any other way, no matter how high and mighty you become, no matter how wealthy you become, no matter how successful you become in the wilderness, you won't enter the promised land. No matter how good you have it here, you're going to end up frustrated, bitterly disappointed. Don't trust this place. And so they build these booths, reading the book of Ecclesiastes, taking festive meals, the Jewish Thanksgiving, in a booth. Now what you do is you take four kinds of plants to decorate it. You take boughs of trees, you take willows, you take ergogs, and you hang them, and you put the palm branches called lulavim on top. A few weeks earlier, these plants were all green. They were fruity and blossoming. And you take your oldest son into the sukkah, the booth, on the Jewish Thanksgiving. And you say to him, Bo beni bo, bo beni bo. Histakel al hagag. Look at the roof. You see these plants? You see these flowers? Remember how just a few weeks ago they were all green and blossoming? And now look at them. They're dead. That's the way our life is in this world, my son. Here today, gone tomorrow. They were so pretty. They seemed to have so much meaning, so much future when they were still blossoming. When you're 20, when you're 30, but when you get to be 40, you begin to think twice. When you begin to be 50, you want to forget to think. By the time you're 70, you will begin to forget how to think. Look at these leaves. Look at this roof. Look how pretty they were just a few weeks ago. How green, how leafy, how fruitful. Now they're dead, my son. Now they're dead. Look at the roof. That's the way life is in this world. For the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of the Lord endures forever. And you hand them the scroll. You see, if all there was a turkey next Thursday, cranberry sauce, not that I don't like turkey and cranberry sauce, as is self-evident, I like a lot of things. But if that's all there was, I don't think I want to be so thankful. I may as well just drink apple cider and watch the football game and say that's all there is with everyone else. But there's much more to be thankful of. The needs God has met in the past, he calls me to remember. The things he's already done for me will give me the faith to trust him for the present and the future, for myself and for others. But I'm not only thanking Jesus for what he's done for me. I'm thanking Jesus for what he's going to do. The nations will come and celebrate the Hebrew Thanksgiving. The nations will come to Jerusalem and celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles. That's Thanksgiving. What does this mean for me? What does it mean for you? What does it mean for this church? What does it mean for your family? Whatever your need is now, whatever you're facing now, no matter how difficult, how challenging, even how seemingly impossible, remember what God did for Israel. And remember what he's already done for you. Remember the things he's already done. He's a God who's worthy to be thanked and praised for what he's done. But as you thank him and praise him for what he's already done, he will give you the faith to trust him and believe him for what he's going to do. Indeed, for what he is already doing. Yes, I thank God for what he has done for me and for my family and for my church. I thank God for what he's done for this church, for you and for your family. I thank God for those things. But I'm already thanking God for what he's going to do that's going to be much greater still. The nations will come to Jerusalem and give thanks to the God of Israel, the Feast of Tabernacles, the Hebrew Thanksgiving. God bless.